How's everyone doing out there? Today I'll be covering the new 2020 Pivot Switchblade, a trail bike boasting 142mm of rear travel and 160mm up front. I'll be analyzing the 29er version of the Switchblade, but optionally you could mount some 27 half tires to it also. Stick around to find out how this DW Link implementation compares to the 147mm Ibis Ripmo, which shares the same suspension platform designed by Dave Weigel. A special shoutout goes to James over at Obsession Bikes in North Vancouver for allowing me to shoot this footage. Extremely knowledgeable guy with years of experience, who was willing to chat with me for quite some time about all sorts of suspension and shock related info. Thanks! Please note that this is not sponsored content. On this channel I always strive to be an objective source of bike related info. My analysis of the Switchblade begins with the anti-rise, a term that describes the braking characteristics of a bike. More anti-rise results in a bike that remains more level while braking, but reduces the responsiveness of the suspension, while less anti-rise leads to a very active suspension under braking, but also doesn't counteract rider weight shifting forward. Much like with the Ibis Ripmo, the Pivot Switchblade has an anti-rise that hovers right around 90% for its entire travel. This is going to be very well suited for steeper trails, and also smoother trails, where you either don't want the rear suspension to allow the bike and yourself to pitch forward over the front wheel, or where you're willing to sacrifice some plushness to gain a very composed bike response under braking. So how does the Switchblade respond under acceleration? Not surprisingly, the anti-squat numbers also follow a similar trend as the Ibis Ripmo, with high values to begin with that level off around 50% and then start decreasing again as you go to full travel. This is going to mean a bike that pedals very efficiently with no pedal bob in the range that you're likely to pedal in. It also means, however, that the suspension might not be extremely plush mid-stroke when climbing technical terrain, for instance, as the suspension will want to resist compression at this point. When you get really deep in the travel, the anti-squat nicely decreases to help reduce pedal kickback and chain force interaction with the suspension to ensure that the suspension remains as plush as possible in the big hits. At this point, you might be thinking to yourself, so these are basically the same bike, just one has 5mm more rear travel. Well, not exactly. The Switchblade has a steeper head angle at 66 degrees versus 64.9 degrees for the Ripmo, which consequently leads to a slightly shorter wheelbase for the Pivot. The Switchblade also has a slacker seat tube angle by 1.5 degrees at 75.5 degrees, paired with a slightly shorter reach. And then there's the leverage ratio. The Switchblade has a very progressive leverage ratio that linearly decreases throughout its travel. This means that it'll have very good small bump compliance and bottom out prevention. But in order to use full travel, you're likely going to have to drop the pressure a little, which means you'll generally sit a little bit deeper in the travel, and you might not have as much mid-travel support. The Ibis Ripmo, by comparison, has a leverage curve that flattens out deep in the travel, and has a smaller leverage ratio overall, meaning that you can run higher pressures to aid in mid-travel support without having a harsh ramp up at the end of the stroke. For hitting the bigger drops, the Switchblade might be a better bet, but for an overall poppy feeling suspension without as much bottom-out support, the Ripmo might be better suited instead. The last thing I'm going to look at with the Switchblade is the wheel path and chain growth. The wheel path follows an arc that is roughly centered just to the top right of the front chainring. The Ibis Ripmo, by comparison, follows an arc that is centered to the top left of the front chainring. This results in a slightly tighter wheel path arc for the Ripmo versus a more vertical wheel path for the Switchblade, which leads to a marginally higher chain growth for the Switchblade at 25.2 mm or 5.8%. Overall, I wouldn't say that these are radically different bikes when it comes to these metrics in particular. So what is my conclusion overall of the new Pivot Switchblade, and how does its DW Link suspension compare to that used on the Ibis Ripmo? Firstly, the anti-rise is high on both bikes, and will keep the bikes level and composed during rear braking. Having it just less than 100% though, means that the suspension won't become ultra firm under braking, and will still be able to maintain traction with the ground. Secondly, the pedaling characteristics of both suspensions follows a very similar trend, with high efficiency during the first 75% of the travel, and then improved plushness during the last 25% of the travel. These bikes should pedal very efficiently with no pedal bob. Thirdly, the leverage ratio of the Switchblade almost linearly falls throughout its travel, and as a result is much more progressive than the Ripmo that levels off deeper in its travel. This is going to provide more bottom-out support for the Switchblade, but potentially be less poppy and sit deeper in its travel compared to the Ripmo. Fourth, there is nothing notable with the wheel path or chain growth compared to other bikes in this category. Based on all this, the Ripmo and Switchblade are similar in many respects, but also differ in some key geometry values and the leverage ratio. It's up to you as to whether you prefer big hit support or mid-travel support, and which bike fits your body geometry better. Thanks for joining me again this week. If you haven't already, make sure to subscribe to the channel and like the video to let me know that you like what I'm doing. And remember, if you want to help support the channel, make sure to head over to my Patreon page using the link down below. Until next time, stay safe.